Hi guys, Mr. Johnny here. In this video I will try to show you a few tips and tricks how to fix a CFL or a dedicated external fluorescent ballast. I'm talking about switch mode ballast. Do not confuse it with a long old-fashioned iron core choke. I'm talking about a compact lightweight switching mode power supplies. Now, straight to the job. Here are a couple of schematics of a simple fluorescent ballast that are made with two transistors, as you can see straight away, without any integrated circuits. Now, what these things are, they are self-oscillating half-bridge power supplies, but they are not the usual power supplies in a sense that they don't have an output power transformer. They have this little transformer, which is this toroid you see here. But that's for the switching of the transistors themselves. That's a feedback transformer. What these things are just inverters. They convert DC, which you get by rectifying mains, into AC, high frequency AC. They do not step up the voltage, neither they step down the voltage. Their purpose is to power the tube with a high frequency AC, because it is a known fact that the tube, if driven with a high frequency, lights up brighter than at the same power level than powered by 50 or 60 hertz. So let's get to it. Let's say you have a tube, you have a lamp or a ballast, you plug it in and nothing happens. It doesn't do anything. It doesn't blink, it doesn't glow red in these ends which are close to the base. Absolutely nothing. You take it out, you crack it open with a little flat blade screwdriver. This thing held by clips, just be careful not to crack the tube. And that's about it. Next. Since the lamp is absolutely dead, what you should really check straight away is to check the tube itself. The fluorescent tube has two filaments in it. You can see it has four wires. One wire there in a insulation, another there, and two here. Between these two, should be a continuity, about 10 ohms worth of resistance. Same applies to this pair. Between these two should be a continuity, and between these two should be a continuity. If there is none, the tube is shut. Just toss it away. Now, toss it into the recycling bin in a proper place. Okay, so let's say the tube is dead, then you can get the ballast and use it for something else or part it out. But let's say the tube is okay, both filaments are fine. Next thing you check is the fuse. Fuse is located in most cases, in all cases I've seen, to be honest, on one of the wires going to the base. One wire is just a simple boring wire, another wire is a heat shrink, wires that has heat shrink on it. Usually it goes to this contact, and it has a what resembles a resistor on it. That might be a fusible resistor, or that might be a fuse in a glass package. It depends on your particular lamp. So check it for continuity. If it's blown, then you should proceed to checking the diode bridge. Sometimes it is a discrete diode. It's made with discrete diodes, as it is here. Hopefully you can see that there are just a bunch of diodes there. Sometimes it is a little package like this. Disregarding how it looks, you should check it. Sometimes diodes go short, because these ballasts run quite hot, and in most fixtures the lamp is located like that, this being the top. So the hot air from the tube, because tube, actual tube runs very hot, rises and heats up the ballast even more. And the ballast by itself heats up quite a lot, so it doesn't help. It accelerates the failure. So check the diodes. They may go open second, they may go short, depends. If your fuse is blown, it's highly likely then if the diodes are faulty, they are shorted. Let's check, you check those, replace as necessary. Then you should check the transistors. Now, to check them properly, you need to desolder them. You desolder them and you check them for shorts, using nothing else than a multimeter. Or if you have transistor tester, you can use that. Some circuits have this anti-parallel diode across the transistors, some don't, as you can see here. So if your circuit has, if your ballast has those diodes, when the transistors are out of circuit, you should check those between here and here. Are these diodes okay? Because it may be that this diode is shorted and not your transistor. But if you measure the transistor in circuit with this diode being shorted, you will think that the transistor is shorted when it's not. So, again, these two transistors, if they are shorted, replace as necessary. Some circuits also have these emitter resistors, purpose of which is to provide some feedback to make the circuit a little bit more thermally stable, to prevent it running away. To stop it from running away, I should say. Okay. When this transistor, if one of these transistors go short, a spike of current flows, and depends on the rating of the fuse, the rating might be quite high, and the current may be high enough to blow one or both of these resistors. So as well, replace as if necessary. Then, what you should really do is to put the thing back together and power it up. Replace the fuse with the appropriate rating. I suggest like a quarter amp fuse will do just fine. Do not use lower values because the spike of current which charges this capacitor may blow very, very small value fuses. The purpose of this fuse is really to prevent the thing catching fire. It will not save any of the components here. If the transistor short out, they will take the fuse out. It's not like the fuse will blow first and prevent damage to the transistors. That never happens. Alright? Replace the fuse, plug the thing in. If it works, great. If it doesn't work, take it apart again, check the fuse again. If it's not blown, okay, you did everything right. But there is something wrong still. And that something wrong is very likely a problem with the startup circuit, which is this couple of resistor, capacitor, diode, and a diac. Diac is a tricky part, and how to describe it? Diac is sort of like a Zener diode, but which breaks down in both directions. It's a symmetric device. So, how this works? Long story short, you plug it in, there is voltage across this capacitor, rectified mains, and this capacitor charges through this resistor slowly, and when the voltage on this capacitor reaches the voltage high enough to break, for this diac to break down, the diac conducts and discharges this capacitor into the base of this transistor and provides a kickstart, a little push for this self-oscillating circuit to get going. And then, if everything is right, it oscillates on itself. So, what can go wrong with a startup circuit? Well, really, what I saw going wrong quite often is the diac itself. I never saw this or this resistor going bad, or this capacitor going bad. Sometimes I see this diode going bad. The purpose of this diode is to shut off the startup circuitry whenever the oscillator is running. So check it with your multimeter, you can check it in circuit. Not a big drama. The tricky thing is that you can test the diac with your multimeter. You can test the diac in a zener tester if you have such, but your zener tester has to have a compliance voltage higher or equal to 30 volts, preferably 40 volts or more. Because although this schematic calls for ST083, most of the ballasts use DB3 diac, which is very easy to find in this case because it's this blue little diode looking device. And if you look at the PCB, you can see that it says DB3, and that's a part number. And this capacitor right here is your timing capacitor. So if you have zener tester, you can take the diac out and test it. It should break down in both directions at about 25 to 35 volts, something like that. Actually, let me show you. Okay, so that's a diac. Hopefully you can read the marking. Not sure. That's a new diac with the long leads. It's tricky to show. Come on, focus. But it says DB3. It's not a zener diode, it's a diac. Hopefully you catch that, but long story short, when you plug it into zener tester, it should break down at the same voltage each time. 25.6, I reverse it. So you get the idea. That's how a prop diode diac in a good condition. That's how it works. Now sometimes diacs fail short circuit, and that way it will be easy for you. You diac should not beep as a short circuit in both ways. It should behave like an. It should show OL on your multimeter when you probe it. Either way. The correct way to probe it is actually use a zener tester, as I showed you. So let's say you don't have it. You pull it out, you replace it with another one, and then it's highly likely that the circuit will just work, because there is not much else that can go wrong here. Now, let's look at the... Now, if the circuit still doesn't work, you really need to go, then you can just go nuts and throw the scene away, or if you like what you're doing, you can spend more time on it or waste more time on it, depending on how you look at things, and test each and every component. As I mentioned, resistors, these high value resistors just work, they don't go bad. Small value resistors may go open circuit because of the excessive current flowing through them. Also, another thing that you should check are the solder joints themselves. Since everything, thanks to restriction of hazardous substances, everything is made with using lead-free solder, this creates an enormous amount of failures because of the simple, ridiculous problem like a cracked solder joint. So you should really check that too. But let's say it works great. Now let's look at the another scenario. You plug it in, and it lights red, glows red, right here and right here. The problem there is ridiculously simple, and I've actually covered it in my old video, but long story short, the component you should be changing, not even checking, because if it glows red, you know it's failed at this capacitor. Pull it out and replace it, easy as that. Another failure, you plug it in and it blinks. It blinks at a low frequency, like 1 or 2 hertz, like blink, blink, blink. The problem there might be the cold solder joint or cracked solder joint somewhere else, somewhere on the board, which effectively kills the feedback. And that blink, blink, blink that you see is the circuit trying to oscillate, because this startup circuit provides those pulses at a low frequency. So that blink, blink, blink is each time it blinks, the diode breaks down and kickstarts the circuit, but the circuit does not have feedback working right, so it doesn't catch on. That can also happen whenever this transistor, the top transistor, fails in open circuit. That can also happen. Let's look at the another scenario. The lamp works, but works strange. What I mean under strange? You plug it in and it lights, it starts up just fine, but it flickers at a reasonably high frequency, like 100 hertz. And some sections of the tube may glow a little bit blue. The problem there is likely this capacitor gone shorted. This capacitor is located near the choke, at the choke, not the transformer, that's this part. This part is this capacitor, and the startup capacitor is usually a small capacitor which is located right here. How you can distinguish what is what? This capacitor between the filaments is low value and high voltage. It is normally rated 1 kilovolt or more, and is usually less or equal to 10 nanofarads. So that's that. Okay, that's about it. That's all the fails that I know of. There is another failure. It's this electrolytic capacitor, which when goes bad, basically why does it go bad? Because as I mentioned, circuit runs hot, and in some fixtures it is located like that, hot air rises, ballast runs very hot, and the electrolytics hate that. They dry out, their ESI rises, which accelerates their demise even more. You can test this part very easily with any ESR tester, just like that. But make sure to short it out before you poke your ESR meter there, because in normal operation there is a peak-to-peak there is peak voltage of your mains right here. And even though the circuit might drain the capacitor to a lower voltage, it's still not a good idea to stick your below piece of test equipment across a charged capacitor, because I did it that once and I really regret it. I fixed the scene after that, but still, it is a dumb mistake. Do not do that. That is about it. If you have any questions, leave them in the comments below. Yes, I know I suck at explaining, but I really try. Hopefully this video is of any use to you. Thanks for watching. See you.